welcome to Expanding the Table. We decided early on that we were going to take some time during this series to dig a little deeper, ask some questions, both of ourselves, Mike and I, but also of our guest speakers. So over the course of the series, we'll have some of our guests here with us, those who could make it, dialoguing about what got them to the place that they're at, what has God been sharing with them, what has God shared with us in the midst of that message, and then how we can move forward together to expand our table in the way that we see Christ expanding the table throughout human history.
Yeah, and I think it's important to mention too that we both come from originally conservative backgrounds and have made this journey theologically to where we are today. And I think that plays in a lot to our conversations we'll have, talking about how in Acts 10, especially, how this widening the table really, you know, challenges the church and reevaluating where it stands theologically. So,
yeah, and I think for us, this series, it's always, for me, interesting to hear from pastors what led to a series coming when it did. And for us, I think this series roots itself in our Thanksgiving traditions, right? That this is that time of year when we gather with our families, and frequently at our tables in all of our families, what, no matter what, you know, whether you've made the kind of trek from kind of fundamentalism that you and I have, both from you as a Pentecostal and me from a Southern Baptist, to whether it's that kind of difference or it's just the difference of politics and life and all of that.
Absolutely.
Like, there is really no more divided places than our Thanksgiving tables with our families, where we're all kind of walking on eggshells and doing careful things. And so as a faith community, we wanted to acknowledge that this is also true in our faith communities, that we're not looking for you to change your mind in all of these places. We're looking for dialogue. So the subtitle of this series is Courageous Conversations. Because if courageous conversations aren't happening in the church, where else are they going to happen?
Absolutely. And I love this story we're going to get into of Acts chapter 10, where we see Peter encountering this great shift in his life of, you know, what he should he eat, what shouldn't he eat, and that how that also spills out to this discussion about Gentiles, and that are they in, are they out? And so often in our society, I feel like in America especially, that we want boxes that people fit in, who's in, who's out, and we want a clear delineation, and this passage just destroys all of that.
It really does. And I think as non-Jews, we don't understand it, how much it destroys it. Right, for a Jew in the time of Jesus, all you had was the law to represent your faithfulness.
Yeah.
Right? It's all you had. And you had the Levitical law, the Deuteronomical law. Mm-hmm. And in one moment, God says to Peter that all of that is in question. Right? So all of the things that he held sacred from his text, the one that he would have read in that time, was now up in the air. That's big. Like, you think about what that would mean to us if God came to you and I, like, still, if God came to me today and said, Rustin, this whole section of the text, you're seeing it and thinking about it wrong. That's hard.
Yeah. And, you know, like you said, to take what, 2000 plus years of Jewish history and thought of how this is supposed to be lived out, and all of a sudden in a moment it to be changed. I mean,
hypothetically 10,000 years, right? Like,
yeah.
If you go all the way back towards like what they would have understood as the beginning, mm-hmm. through Abraham, through Moses, through the prophets, and now we're 400 years past the last written text, that's where we're at in this, right? So we're in this 400 years of silence, and Jesus enters the space to tell a new story. And this is even after Jesus' death, right? So,
yeah.
And Peter is like a faithful Jew. So to be up on this roof, have this dream where God lowers it and says, Peter, everything that you thought was unclean, take it, need it, was a revolutionary moment that I think the church doesn't talk about enough. And in fact, there's been scholars talk about that in that story, he tells the same story three times.
Uh-huh.
And the cost of paper in the time of the writing of Acts, the papyrus,
yeah.
was so expensive. So you didn't waste your time saying the same things over and over. And so part of the point of what scholars would say is this is super important because there's two full times the story is told within this chapter, but really three moments that could have been shrunk down to a much smaller moment to tell the story. But the author wanted to ground us in this kind of transitionary moment in the life of the church in Acts chapter 10.
Yeah, well, that makes sense. I mean, again, the things we don't think about being in this place, in this culture right now, that, you know, the cost of just getting a piece of paper, right? Yeah. My kids have a cabinet. We pull paper all the time. I can't imagine what it'd be like to make your own paper. So,
exactly. Yeah.
So, I mean, you go through Sunday's message. If you haven't listened to Sunday's message, go online. You'll see the link in this video where you can see and listen to this last week's Sunday service. But you talk about also Ruth, and you talk about the Moabites, and you weave this interesting tale about how even before this story, God is seeming to make inroads for people that are on the outside. Like, how do you see God? It seems like God's always been at work trying to make inroads for the outsider, even though his people seem to get it wrong all the time.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's what you see. And in fact, I think you don't just see it in the person of Jesus. We like to just place this kind of transitionary moment in the life of Jesus, but actually you see it way before that. And part of, I think, the space where it becomes most clear is in the genealogies of Jesus that you read in Matthew, right? So in that genealogy, Ruth is one of the ones that's brought up. Ruth was a Moabite, and in Leviticus, it says that Moabites would never enter the kingdom, right? Like that they were forbidden from connection to God. And yet in Jesus's own lineage, in the lineage of David, there is this Moabite woman. And when you read the rest of them, right? Like people who...
And not just any Moabite woman, but just, you know, this woman who, like you said, becomes the grandfather or grandmother of David, the king.
Who then becomes the great, 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 great grandmother of Jesus.
Yeah.
Right? Like this is like, so here's one who was, again, forbidden from being a part of the kingdom all the way back then in Levitical law, and now is seen as the representation of faithfulness and committed relationship.
That's really good.
In the lineage of Jesus. In that same lineage, right, you have a woman who kind of prostituted herself in order to hold honor for her family. So you have prostitutes, you see women honored in the stories of Jesus in a way that wasn't culturally appropriate at the time. You see Jesus honoring Gentiles, not just here, but in other realities. You see lepers, you see Samaritans. Jesus, right, like even in the act of the Eucharistic space that Jesus creates at the Last Supper, he welcomes the traitor, who he knew was a traitor, at the same equal footing as everyone else around the table.
I love thinking about that last moment with Jesus at the table, because it not only is the traitor there, you have the deserter, you have the skeptic, you have, you know, the people that would say, we're going to be there no matter what, and they're gone.
They're gone. Absolutely. And then so then you think about Nebuchadnezzar. We just finished the study in Daniel, and like three full chapters of that book are God pursuing the head of an empire who conquered his own people.
Yeah, and not in a nice way.
but also pursuing him with love, absolutely. Right? That he wanted relationship with Nebuchadnezzar and pursues and pursues and pursues and pursues Nebuchadnezzar, trying to get Nebuchadnezzar to understand who God is in the midst of this. Then you think about the poor and the Ninevites, right? Like that whole story of Jonah is another group of people who were outsiders that God says, no, you go tell them that I love them and they're in.
Yeah.
Right? Eunuchs, it's another group, tax collectors, all of these people. Like, I think we lose sight of how all of these people were hated by the church, or what was the synagogue at the time, right? Like, that they were all hated by the religious group, and that's who God brings in.
Yeah, because in our understanding, all these stories, again, I always tell people that we Disney-fy the Bible a lot, right?
Yeah.
We come to it with our understanding, with our thoughts, and we love the underdog, and so we're automatically rooting for them to be in and all that, and you know, but the Bible is not telling those stories from that perspective. Yeah. It's telling it from the perspective, these guys are out of God's grace, and yet it's God who's coming to them and inviting them again and again and again.
Which to me is a part of what I loved most about this story and the studying of this story is, you know, I believe that Acts is actually the story of the Holy Spirit. Mm. more than it's the story of the church.
Yeah.
Right. Like, I think we want it to be the story of how the church began. Right.
Absolutely. But
it's really the story of this third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, as Jesus has left this spirit to be with his disciples. It had always been there. Right. But it is now taking the place of prominence in this story. And we start tracing the Spirit's movement and how the church is catching up. Right, the Spirit's always ahead. And I think that's one of the fascinating parts for me about this text, is that part of the role of the church, part of the history of the church, mm-hmm. has been trying to catch where the Spirit is opening God's grace up to the world.
Yeah.
And we've been historically behind on that. Mm-hmm. Right? Like, it's not like, so this is less of a judgment from us in our milieu that we've come saying, how dare, but no, like, this is our history. Like, we've always been had a problem with this.
So what do you say? Like, you know, going back, your current you speaking to you, you know, 20, 30 years ago, right? What do you say to that person who is so in that place right now where, you know, well, this is what the Bible says? How do you help them realize that there was an orthodoxy pre-America that wrestled? You see it again in this story in Acts later on, right? You see Peter and Paul wrestling with this idea of Gentiles, where Peter initially gets it right, and then at the end, he makes a mistake. He falls back under the pressure of others, right? And says, well, Gentiles maybe should do this and this and this. And Paul's like, no, what's going on here? So how do you speak to someone, you know, in that position now of like,
So two things. Number one, I don't know that myself 25 years ago would speak to the person I am now, which says something about where I was 25 years ago.
Yeah.
But I would start by saying the Bible doesn't say anything. Hmm. The Bible reads.
Interesting. Yeah.
And I think that that's one of the differentiations that has shifted my understanding in such powerful ways, because as a conservative evangelical growing up in that space and what that meant, right? The power was the Bible first,
yeah,
and only, mm-hmm. right? And I still believe in the power of the Bible, but I believe it's the power of the Bible as it reveals the true word,
okay,
that is Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. to the followers of Jesus that matters. And the Bible isn't speaking to us. It reads it. We read it and we interpret it. And so in places where we're interpreting hate, in places where we're interpreting that difference matters more than God's grace, I would say we're reading it wrong. It's not telling us the wrong things. Mm. Right. So it's like, for me, part of what we're trying to discern this moment is the world's changing, and the Bible reveals to us how the people of the time it was written understood God's revelation in that space.
That's good, yes.
And what our job is, as the people of the generations that follow that, is to say, what does this read to us now that is in relationship with how the world has changed and how we understand God in the midst of it? And that's hard, right? Some people will hear that and they'll be like, man, that's Russ, that's a really slippery slope.
Yeah,
like
I've been there.
You know, like, isn't it you just interpreting this the way that you want?
Yeah.
And again, I think what I said on Sunday is I think there are checks and balances. Mm-hmm. I think love as a lens in which we read really matters. So if something is coming out unloving, we need to reread it and figure out where we're wrong.
I love that. That's the what I've gotten out of this movement is the canon within the canon, right?
Yep.
And seeing the Bible through that lens of loving God and loving neighbor first, and then, you know, expanding out from there.
Yeah, so just in case people don't know what a canon is, yeah. A canon isn't like a blasting agent, like it's not a weapon. A canon is a collection of texts,
yes.
Right? So the Bible is known as a collection. The Bible is a library, not a book.
Yes.
And so in this canon, in this collection of texts, there's an internal canon, and it's the love God, love neighbor, love self canon, mm-hmm. that everything else is interpreted in the rest of the canon through that lens.
Yeah.
Luther was big on this frame, right?
Like, yeah, I think it's powerful.
And so I would say that the love lens is the first check. I think the second check is when it comes to the Holy Spirit, it's the scriptures are clear in Galatians that the Spirit has certain fruit, mm-hmm. and it's love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control, and faithfulness. I think I missed one. But whatever they are, right? Like in that Galatians text, I think we can ask the question of, are those things rooted and rooting themselves, growing out of these things that we're seeing? So when like Jesus is having these meals, if you look at these meals, it's the non-religious who are showing love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control.
Absolutely.
It's the religious who are showing judgment, vindication, doubt, fear, these things, right? And so what we're seeing in these meals, these expand when Jesus expands the table, right? Uh-huh. When we see in these meals, is Jesus just sliding in with the Spirit?
Yeah.
Right? And responding to where the Spirit is in place and living in that. And I think that's a very safe bet for us as followers of Jesus of how we do this.
Yeah. To end our talk, you know, I love the idea of Jesus being at the table and the Pharisees are saying, look, he eats with sinners and the people he shouldn't be eating with. Doesn't he know that? And so throughout this series, we're going to be doing this every Friday and kind of having a discussion. And we want to invite you also to participate in this. And so, you know, if there's questions that you have, feel free to use the email on the bottom of the page or use the link below just to reach out to us with your questions. We'd love to kind of spend some time and answer the questions that you might have. And then also we have some resources. We just recently went through Daniel. We recently went through understanding the Bible, right, in a different level. And so if there's other resources that you might find helpful, we're going to also link those below on our page. So
awesome. Yeah. This is, you know, at the end of the day, what we hope, our prayer for you and for us is like we said every Sunday, like these rhythms that we have are all about falling more in love with God, more in love with our neighbor, and more in love with ourselves as God is creating us to be.
Yeah.
And so our desire with this other content, right, is to do exactly that, to challenge us to fall deeper in love with God and with our neighbor and with ourselves in the coming weeks.